go ahead and open up your Bibles to the book of Nehemiah. Was there with the king, and the king could see that he was sad, and he Nehemiah explains that he was sad, why he was sad, and he trusted God that the king would listen to him and help him through that. So now we're going to look at another tool, a couple of other tools today. So let's pray here first. God, we thank you for your word. We thank you that it is true, that the Bible is true. Mm-hmm. We trust your word. We thank you for giving us the word of God. And this word of God helps us to know what is true. There's many people here today who are just lost and don't know what to do with my life or what to do next. And God, we can follow your word, which gives us the path of where to walk. It doesn't have to be hard. God, help us not to be focused on ourselves or with focus on politics or whatever it may be, but that we would put our eyes on you and stay focused on you, God. Give us strength to stand, to be committed, to decide to walk with you and to be consistent, that we wouldn't quit. Give us strength. So last week we read these verses here. We saw Nehemiah talk to the king and ask the king if he could go to his hometown, and he said how long do you need, and he told him, and then Nehemiah had some requests, right? He requested the king to give him some letters. He needed those letters from the king to have proof for him to be able to travel through all the countries. He also asked for some wood, some supplies, and so then Nehemiah goes. Here in verse 9, we see in verse 9, Nehemiah says, okay, so he's going to go. And it says, then I came to the governors beyond the river and gave the king's letter. Now the king had sent captains of the army and horsemen with me. This is cool here. Not only did the king give Nehemiah the authority through the letters, the approval for him to go, gave him the letters that would show that it was okay by the king, and gave him the supplies, and then also we see here, he gave him his own personal bodyguards. You know, you've seen this, these bodyguards walk around with the president, right, with their technology, and so here we see the king has given him, like, Secret Service, right? Who follow Nehemiah around. It shows that the king wanted to care, had to care for Nehemiah, wanted to keep him safe. And so the king gives these things to Nehemiah, and Nehemiah didn't say, oh, you know what? Actually, I'm going to change my schedule around a little bit, and let's hold off on this. Let me put it, add it to my calendar and work it out on my schedule. He didn't do that. As soon as he got to go, he went. He didn't delay. Nehemiah was ready and he went. He did it. Let's look at this map here. So right here is Susa. That is where Nehemiah was living. And so he's traveling all this way. Until he gets to Jerusalem. How long did it take for him to travel? We guess maybe about 10 to 14 days. If he, you know, kept on going, if he had to make several stops, then maybe longer than that. Most of the time when you travel that route, it's usually traveled by camel, sometimes by horse, and again, you know, there would be several stops in the animals. Someone just asked how many miles. I don't know exactly how many miles there is that route. And it wasn't an easy route. There's lots of mountains. It's not like highway, you know, right? So some tough terrain there. And so Nehemiah is traveling. Notice here where it says, I came to the governors. What is that? Who's the governor? So this is pretty big here. This is a lot of land. One king is in rule of it all. Can that happen for one king? Well, it can, yes. But you would need some rulers to take over areas of this land, different areas, and those would be the governors. You know, like remember during the Roman time, they had Pilate, remember, during Jesus' crucifixion. There was Pilate who was the governor, known as the governor. He had to make sure that he followed the law that was above him and made sure that his region was following those laws. And so this is Nehemiah traveling through and meeting governors. And actually, they are named here. There's two of them mentioned here, Sanballat and Tobiah. These two men are mentioned, and we'll see a third man mentioned a little bit later. But just to let you know, these guys in this story are actually the bad guys. When you're watching a movie and you see a person come on and try to figure out if they're good or if they're the bad guy. But I'm telling you right now that these guys are the bad guys in this. Well, Pastor Mark, how do you know that? Well, notice here it says that when Sanballat, the Horonite, which explains where he's from, which region, or area, and then Tobiah, the servant, the Ammonite, heard of it. It grieved them exceedingly. Why are they grieved? And not only just a little bit, it says exceedingly. They were very upset. They were not happy here. Why? Why were they not happy? Because there was come a man to seek the welfare of the children of Israel. A man had come to help. And these guys aren't happy about it. Again, you see here all this land here. And Israel is just this little spot right here. And although it's small, this, which is still here today, then the kings of Eden, Moab, Ammon. So we're going to see these three men in this story who are the bad guys. The first guy, which was the Hornite from Moab, and the other one, the Ammonite, is from Ammon, and then the other, the third one, which we'll see in a little bit, so again, here we see that these guys are upset because Nehemiah has come to help the children of Israel. Why would they be upset? Nehemiah came to Jerusalem and was there 3 days. He had traveled a long journey, and so he took a couple days to maybe watch a football game, and he was ready to go to work. No, he didn't do that. And so when did he start working? Started working in the nighttime. He didn't take 3 days off. job, he started working at night because he didn't want others to see. So first they had looked around at the land and came up with a plan, and he went to work. He says, "And I arose in the night, I and some few men with me. Neither told I any man what my God had put in my heart to do at Jerusalem. Neither was there any beast with me except the beast that I rode upon." And so here Nehemiah goes out by night by the gate of the valley, even before the dragon well, and to the dung port. What are we talking about here? I'll show you on the map in a minute. And so, and what the point is here is that he is taking a look around. He viewed the walls of Jerusalem, which were broken down, sure enough, and the gates were consumed with fire. Then I went on to the gate of the fountain and to the king's pool. But there was no place for the beast that was under me to pass. Then I went up in the night by the brook and viewed the wall and went back and turned back and entered back by the gate of the valley and so returned. So this here is not exactly what it might have looked like, but it's just an idea. This is one of Jerusalem. There's another one that's different. So, I mean, it's just a guess, an idea of what it could have looked like. So Nehemiah is out right here. And he's taking a look around. You know, there's the dung gate. That's what he's talking about. He's cool right there. And he was stuck right there where he was saying that he couldn't get through with his animal, his beast. And so then over here, you would see, you saw the brook. And after he was done, he went back inside again. And so that's what Nehemiah said that he did. It looks like it's big, but it's really actually a pretty small city. Maybe 10 miles long, probably 10 miles. So maybe that can walk around maybe 3 miles or something. That's a guess. You can walk 3 miles, right? And I'll be walking 3 miles in less than an hour. And with the animal and taking a look around, I don't know. Nehemiah's goal was to just kind of look and see and make a plan. Remember when Nehemiah heard that Jerusalem was destroyed, he prayed and he trusted God to be to go. And then when he goes and he gets there and takes a look, he's thinking, wow, this is worse than I thought. You know what? I'm not going to be able to do this. Just forget it. I'm going to go back home. It's just too much work. Remember that this has been looking like this for 100 years. It's been left like this for 100 years. Nobody has done anything about it. These walls have been destroyed. It's been sitting here for 100 years, and Nehemiah gets there. And also, Nehemiah's specialty is not an engineer or a carpenter, he was just a cupbearer. He gets there and he could have been like, you know what, this this is way above my pay level. I'm going home. But no, he was determined. He said, I came here to do something, and I'm going to do it. So we go on, and Sanballat and the rulers, the rulers did not know where I went. They didn't know what I did. Neither had I yet told it to the Jews, nor to the priests, or to the nobles, or to the rulers, nor to the rest that did the work. It was just me, myself. And so then I gathered everyone around. Then I said unto them, ye see the distress that we are in. Look at this place. Jerusalem lies waste, and the gates have been burned with fire. Come, let us build up the wall of Jerusalem, that we be no more a reproach. Not only was Nehemiah determined, he was committed. Even after he saw that this was going to be a huge job, and all the people who lived there just accepted it, that was just the way it was going to be. This is our life, and it's just going to look like this, and it's always been that way. And so since I was little, and I've grown up here, and there's no improvement, you know, it just won't get better. It just can't get better. That's my life. I can't get better. And Nehemiah is saying, what? Aren't you embarrassed? Look at this place. Look around. Look at your city. It is a mess. Let me ask you, is your life a mess? If your life is a mess, oh, well, it's been this way, you know, and that's just the way it is. You know, I talk to people all the time, and people say, you know, yeah, I know my life is in a mess, and I don't know how to make it better, and that's just the way it is for me. Take a look. You have an opportunity to improve, to get better. You can do better for yourself. What does it take? Right? Prayer, trust, make some decisions, some hard decisions. What did Nehemiah do? He left his job. How was he going to get paid? He just left his job. That's a hard decision. And he traveled all that way, a dangerous journey, and so he finally gets there, and then these guys don't like him, and there he was committed. Then he takes a look at it, and it's awful, it's a mess, and he was consistent, and he just kept going. He's like, come on guys, let's do something about this. We're going to build these walls up. Come on, this is embarrassment. Let's change this. He was motivating these people. And then you see, he said, I told them of the hand of God, which is good upon me, that God's hand is on me. And also the king's words. He said, you know what? The king said that I could do this, that we could do this. And the people are listening to Nehemiah, and they start believing him. They're getting on board. They're saying, yeah, you know, we can do this. And they're talking to each other, and they're, yeah, we can do this. 100 years it's been like this. Then they start thinking, oh, yeah, we could change. wish the chapter stops here. But it doesn't. Let's look, verse 19. Here comes the bad guys. Sanballat and Tobiah and Geshem. Here's the third guy. Geshem of the Arabian. So these guys heard it. Nehemiah gathered all these people around and said, we're going to build these walls. And these people are getting excited, like, yeah, we can do this. And the three bad guys come in and they just start laughing. They're laughing. Saying, you're dumb. You're stupid. You think you can change this place? Just laughing. And making fun of them. Despise us. It's already been overcome and overtaken and they're just mocking them and making fun of them, bringing them down. And how did Nehemiah respond? Could be discouraged from this. These three guys are the governors. They're the boss of this area. These three guys, they have power. They have some military, some kings above them, and so this is a challenge for Nehemiah. You know, if you have made a decision to do something right with your life, and you made the decision to follow God, guess what? You are going to be against opposition. I guarantee it. Once you draw closer to God, and the closer you get, the more enemies will show up. If you have no opposition in your life, no enemies, no, something's not right. These three guys are Nehemiah's enemies and the enemy of God. Talk to them, and their goal is to see the Bible diminished, God diminished. Their goal, that's their goal. You have power to overcome them. I love Nehemiah's response here. He doesn't get discouraged and Christians, don't quit. When you face a challenge or something, oh, you know what? This is just too hard. You know what? Forget it. I quit. I'm done with this. Somebody at church hurt my feelings. You know what? I'm offended. Don't quit. Keep going. Don't quit. Notice here Nehemiah's response. I love his response here. He answered, then answered I them and said unto them, the God of heaven, he will prosper us. Therefore, we rise and build. Oh, you're going to sit there and laugh with us and mock us. You know what? I know the one true king, and it's not Artaxerxes. This king is the God of heaven, and I trust him. The Lord God, he will take care of us. Therefore, we are his servants, and we will rise up, and we will build up this place. You're not going to stop us. I simply don't care what you have to say. But opposition happens, and they're saying all this stuff and laughing at us, and you know what? God's going to take care of me, and he kept on going. Nehemiah used his tools. And so far we've looked at prayer and trust and that determination. He persisted. These are the tools that we see in Nehemiah that helped him succeed. You might say, okay, well, great. Good for him. Well, what about you? This can happen to you, too. You could be the same. It still works today. Do you decide and persist? There's an old song, an old hymn that says, I have decided to follow Jesus. No How did you get into this mess in the first place? Well, because of your weakness, because of your sin, you need God to help you. To save you from your sin. You've got to follow Him. You've got to make that decision. The turning. To do the work. Thoughts in my mind will say, oh, you're going to fail. You think you can do this? And just thoughts, these negative thoughts, you know? Maybe like the devil or the angel on each side of the shoulder, but you know, sometimes it feels like that. And that's the enemy. That is the enemy. Sometimes I'm my own worst enemy, right? But persistence. Help come from? challenge, I should say, to make the decision. Will you follow the word? And secondly, be persistent, because it's hard. You may be tired. Keep going. You feel tired? Keep going. You do all the work? Keep going. Oh, enemy, negativity, keep going. Don't quit. I'm going to close here with prayer. God, thank you for your grace. You know, I have failed many times. I have. And I know that there are people in this room who have failed. God, I'm thankful that you have never quit on me. Thank you that you haven't given up on Mark. Oh, he's failed so many times. I'm done with him. No, but God, instead, you just love me so much. You have forgiven me so much. And you take care of me so much, and you changed me so much. God, my goal is to help others and point others to the cross, point people to you. Lord, I pray that the people here today would make a decision. Maybe it's, I made the decision long ago. Well, maybe you need to decide again today. You know, you have made some mistakes along the way, and I'm going to make this decision again today to follow you, Lord. God will prosper me.